Moral statistician, I don't want any of your statistics. I took your whole batch and lit my pipe with it. I hate your kind of people. You are always ciphering out how much a man's health is injured, and how much his intellect is impaired, and how many pitiful dollars and cents he wastes in the course of 92 years' indulgence in the fatal practice of smoking, and in the equally fatal practice of drinking coffee, and in playing billiards occasionally, and in taking a glass of wine at dinner, etc., etc., etc. And you are always figuring out how many women have been burned to death because of the dangerous fashion of wearing expansive hoops, etc., etc., etc. You never see more than one side of the question. You are blind to the fact that most old men in America smoke and drink coffee, although, according to your theory, they ought to have died young. And that hardy old Englishmen drink wine and survive it, and portly old Dutchmen both drink and smoke freely, and yet grow older and fatter all the time. And you never try to find out how much solid comfort, relaxation, and enjoyment a man derives from smoking in the course of a lifetime, which is worth 10 times the money he would save by letting it alone. Nor the appalling aggregate of happiness lost in a lifetime by your kind of people from not smoking. Of course, you can save money by denying yourself all those little vicious enjoyments for 50 years, but then what can you do with it? What use can you put it to? Money can't save your infinitesimal soul. All the use that money can be put to is to purchase comfort and enjoyment in this life. Therefore, as you are an enemy to comfort and enjoyment, where is the use in accumulating cash? It won't do for you to say that you can use it to better purpose in furnishing a good table, and in charities, and in supporting tract societies, because you know yourself that you people who have no petty vices are never known to give away a cent, and that you stint yourselves so in the matter of food that you are always feeble and hungry. And you never dare to laugh in the daytime for fear some poor wretch, seeing you in a good humor, will try to borrow a dollar of you. And in church you are always down on your knees with your eyes buried in the cushion when the contribution box comes around. And you never give the revenue officers a true statement of your income. Now you know all these things yourself, don't you? Very well then, what is the use of your stringing out your miserable lives to a lean and withered old age? What is the use of your saving money that is so utterly worthless to you? In a word, why don't you go off somewhere and die, and not be always trying to seduce people into becoming as ornery and unlovable as you are yourselves by your ceaseless and villainous moral statistics? Now, I don't approve of dissipation, and I don't indulge in it either, but I haven't a particle of confidence in a man who has no redeeming petty vices whatever, and so I don't want to hear from you any more. I think you are the very same man who read me a long lecture last week about the degrading vice of smoking cigars, and then came back in my absence with your vile, reprehensible, fireproof gloves on, and carried off my beautiful parlor stove. Simon Wheeler, Sonora. The following simple and touching remarks and accompanying poem have just come to hand from the rich gold mining region of Sonora. To Mr. Mark Twain. The within parson, which I have set to poetry under the name and style of He Done His Level Best, was one among the whitest men I ever see, and it at every man that knowed him that can find it in his heart to say he's glad the poor cuss is busted and gone home to the States. He was here in an early day, and he was the handiest man about taking holt of anything that come along you most ever see, I judge. He was a cheerful, stirrin' creeter, always doing something, and no man can say he ever see him do anything by havers. Preachin' was his natural gait, but he warn't a man to lay back and twiddle his thumbs, because there didn't happen to be nothin' doin' in his own ephesial line. No, sir, he was a man who would meander forth and stir up somethin' for hisself. His last acts was to go his pile on King's Anne, calculatin' to fill, but which he didn't fill, when there was a flush out agin him, and naturally, you see, he went under. And so he was cleaned out, as you may say, and he struck the home trail, cheerful but flat broke. I knowed this talented man in Arkansas, and if you would print this humbly tribute to his gorgeous abilities, you would greatly oblige his unhappy friend. He done his level best. Was he a mining on the flat? He done it with a zest. Was he a leading of the choir? He done his level best. If he'd a regular task to do, he never took no rest. Or if 'twas off and on the same, he done his level best. If he was preaching on his beat, he'd tramp from east to west, and north to south in cold and heat, he done his level best. He'd yank a sinner out in Hades and land him with the blessed, then snatch a prayer and waltz in again and do his level best. He'd cuss and sing and howl and pray and dance and drink and jest, and lie and steal, all one to him, he done his level best. Whatever this man was sought to do, he done it with a zest. No matter what his contract was, he'd do his level best. Here I have taken a slight liberty with the original Miss Hades does not make such good meter as the other word of one syllable, but it sounds better. Verily, this man was gifted with gorgeous abilities, and it is a happiness to me to embalm the memory of their luster in these columns. If it were not that the poet crop is unusually large and rank in California this year, I would encourage you to continue writing, Simon. But as it is, perhaps it might be too risky in you to enter against so much opposition. Inquirer wishes to know which is the best brand of smoking tobacco, and how it is manufactured. The most popular, mind I do not feel at liberty to give an opinion as to the best, and so I simply say the most popular, smoking tobacco is the miraculous conglomerate they call Killikinick. It is composed of equal parts of tobacco stems, chopped straw, old soldiers, fine shavings, oak leaves, dog fennel, corn shucks, sunflower petals, outside leaves of the cabbage plant, and any refuse of any description whatever that costs nothing and will burn. After the ingredients are thoroughly mixed together, they are run through a chopping machine and soaked in a spittoon. The mass is then sprinkled with fragrant Scotch snuff, packed into various seductive shapes, labeled Genuine Killikinick, from the old original manufactory at Richmond, and sold to consumers at $1 a pound. The choicest brands contain a double portion of Old Soldiers and sell at $1 and fly half. Genuine Turkish tobacco contains a treble quantity of Old Soldiers and is worth $2 or $3 according to the amount of service the said Old Soldiers have previously seen. N.B. This article is preferred by the Sultan of Turkey. His picture and autograph are on the label. Take a handful of Killikinick, crush it as fine as you can, and examine it closely, and you will find that you can make as good an analysis of it as I have done. You must not expect to discover any particles of genuine tobacco by this rough method, however. To do that, it will be necessary to take your specimen to the mint and subject it to a fire assay. A good article of cheap tobacco is now made of chopped pine straw and Spanish moss. It contains one Old Soldier to the ton, and is called Fine Old German Tobacco. Professional beggars, no, you are not obliged to take greenbacks at par. Melton Mowbray, Dutch Flat. This correspondent sends a lot of doggerel, and says it has been regarded as very good in Dutch flat. I give a specimen in verse. The Assyrian came down like a wolf on the fold, and his cohorts were gleaming in purple and gold. And the sheen of his spears shone like stars on the sea, when the blue wave rolls nightly on deep Galilee. This piece of pleasantry, published in a San Francisco paper, was mistaken by the country journals for seriousness, and many and loud were their denunciations of the ignorance of author and editor in not knowing that the lines in question were written by Byron. There, that will do. That may be very good Dutch flat poetry, but it won't do in the metropolis. It is too smooth and blubbery. It reads like buttermilk gurgling from a jug. What the people ought to have is something spirited, something like Johnny Comes Marching Home. However, keep on practicing, and you may succeed yet. There is genius in you, but too much blubber. Amateur Serenader. Yes, I will give you some advice, and do it with a good deal of pleasure. I live in a neighborhood which is well stocked with young ladies, and consequently, I am excruciatingly sensitive upon the subject of serenading. Sometimes I suffer. In the first place, always tune your instruments before you get within 300 yards of your destination. This will enable you to take your adored unawares and create a pleasant surprise by launching out at once upon your music. It astonishes the dogs and cats out of their presence of mind, too, so that if you hurry, you can get through before they have a chance to recover and interrupt you. Besides, there is nothing captivating in the sounds produced in turning a lot of melancholy guitars and fiddles, and neither does a group of able-bodied sentimental young men so engaged look at all dignified. Secondly, clear your throats and do all the coughing you have got to do before you arrive at the seat of war. I have known a young lady to be ruthlessly startled out of her slumbers by such a sudden and direful blowing of noses and humming and coughing that she imagined the house was beleaguered by victims of consumption from the neighboring hospital. Do you suppose the music was able to make her happy after that? Thirdly, don't stand right under the porch and howl, but get out in the middle of the street. Or better still, on the other side of it. Distance lends enchantment to the sound. If you have previously transmitted a hint to the lady that she is going to be serenaded, she will understand whom the music is for. Besides, if you occupy a neutral position in the middle of the street, maybe all the neighbors round will take stock in your serenade and invite you to take wine with them. Fourthly, don't sing a whole opera through. Enough of a thing's enough. Fifthly, don't sing Lily Dale. The profound satisfaction that most of us derive from the reflection that the girl treated of in that song is dead is constantly marred by the resurrection of the lugubrious ditty itself by your kind of people. Sixthly, don't let your screaming tenor soar an octave above all the balance of the chorus and remain there, setting everybody's teeth on edge for four blocks around. And above all, don't let him sing it solo. Probably there is nothing in the world so suggestive of serene contentment and perfect bliss as the spectacle of a calf chewing a dish rag. But the nearest approach to it is your reedy tenor, standing apart, in sickly attitude, with head thrown back and eyes uplifted to the moon, piping his distressing solo. Now do not pass lightly over this matter, friend, but ponder it with that seriousness which its importance entitles it to. Seventhly, after you have run all the chickens and dogs and cats in the vicinity distracted, and roused them into a frenzy of crossing, and cackling, and yawling, and caterwauling, put up your dreadful instruments and go home. Eighthly, as soon as you start, gag your tenor. Otherwise, he will be letting off a screech every now and then to let the people know he is around. Your amateur tenor is notoriously the most self-conceited of all God's creatures. Tenthly, don't go serenading at all. It is a wicked, unhappy, and seditious practice, and a calamity to all souls that are weary and desire to slumber and would be at rest. Eleventhly and lastly, the father of the young lady in the next block says that if you come prowling around his neighborhood again with your infamous scraping and tooting and yelling, he will sally forth and deliver you into the hands of the police. As far as I am concerned myself, I would like to have you come, and come often. But as long as the old man is so prejudiced, perhaps you had better serenade mostly in Oakland, or San Jose, or around there somewhere. St. Clair Higgins, Los Angeles. My life is a failure. I have adored, wildly, madly, and she whom I love has turned coldly from me and shed her affections upon another. What would you advise me to do? You should shed your affections on another also, or on several, if there are enough to go around. Also, do everything you can to make your former flame unhappy. There is an absurd idea disseminated in novels that the happier a girl is with another man, the happier it makes the old lover she has blighted. Don't allow yourself to believe any such nonsense as that. The more cause that girl finds to regret that she did not marry you, the more comfortable you will feel over it. It isn't poetical, but it is mighty sound doctrine. Arithmeticus, Virginia, Nevada. If it would take a cannonball 3 3/8 seconds to travel 4 miles, and 3 1/3 seconds to travel the next 4, and 3 5/8 to travel the next 4, and if its rate of progress continued to diminish in the same ratio, how long would it take to go 1,500 millions of miles? I don't know. Ambitious Learner, Oakland. Yes, you are right. America was not discovered by Alexander Selkirk. Discarded Lover. I loved, and still love, the beautiful Edwitha Howard and intended to marry her. Yet during my temporary absence at Benicia, last week, alas, she married Jones. Is my happiness to be thus blasted for life? Have I no redress? Of course you have. All the law, written and unwritten, is on your side. The intention and not the act constitutes crime. In other words, constitutes the deed. If you call your bosom friend a fool and intend it for an insult, it is an insult. But if you do it playfully, and meaning no insult, it is not an insult. If you discharge a pistol accidentally and kill a man, you can go free, for you have done no murder. But if you try to kill a man and manifestly intend to kill him, but fail utterly to do it, the law still holds that the intention constituted the crime, and you are guilty of murder. Ergo, if you had married Edwitha accidentally and without really intending to do it, you would not actually be married to her at all, because the act of marriage could not be complete without the intention. And, ergo, in the strict spirit of the law, since you deliberately intended to marry Edwitha and didn't do it, you are married to her all the same. Because, as I said before, the intention constitutes the crime. It is as clear as day that Edwitha is your wife, and your redress lies in taking a club and mutilating Jones with it as much as you can. Any man has a right to protect his own wife from the advances of other men. But you have another alternative. You were married to Edwitha first because of your deliberate intention, and now you can prosecute her for bigamy in subsequently marrying Jones. But there is another phase in this complicated case. You intended to marry Edwitha, and consequently, according to law, she is your wife. There is no getting around that. But she didn't marry you, and if she never intended to marry you, you are not her husband, of course. Ergo, in marrying Jones, she was guilty of bigamy because she was the wife of another man at the time, which is all very well as far as it goes. But then, don't you see, she had no other husband when she married Jones, and consequently she was not guilty of bigamy. Now, according to this view of the case, Jones married a spinster, who was a widow at the same time, and another man's wife at the same time, and yet who had no husband and never had one, and never had any intention of getting married, and therefore, of course, never had been married. And by the same reasoning, you are a bachelor, because you have never been anyone's husband, and a married man, because you have a wife living, and to all intents and purposes a widower, because you have been deprived of that wife, and a consummate ass for going off to Benicia in the first place, while things were so mixed. And by this time, I have got myself so tangled up in the intricacies of this extraordinary case that I shall have to give up any further attempt to advise you. I might get confused and fail to make myself understood. I think I could take up the argument where I left off, and by following it closely a while, perhaps I could prove to your satisfaction either that you never existed at all, or that you are dead now, and consequently don't need the faithless Edwitha. I think I could do that if it would afford you any comfort. Persecuted unfortunate, you say you owe 6 months' board, and you have no money to pay it with, and your landlord keeps harassing you about it, and you have made all the excuses and explanations possible, and now you are at a loss what to say to him in the future. Well, it is a delicate matter to offer advice in a case like this, but your distress impels me to make a suggestion, at least since I cannot venture to do more. When he next importunes you, how would it do to take him impressively by the hand and ask, with simulated emotion, Monsieur Jean, votre chien, comment se porte-t-il? Doubtless that is very bad French, but you will find that it will answer just as well as the unadulterated article. Arthur Augustus. No, you are wrong. That is the proper way to throw a brickbat or a tomahawk. But it doesn't answer so well for a bouquet. You will hurt somebody if you keep it up. Turn your nosegay upside down, take it by the stems, and toss it with an upward sweep. Did you ever pitch quoits? That is the idea. The practice of recklessly heaving immense solid bouquets of the general size and weight of prize cabbages from the dizzy altitude of the galleries is dangerous and very reprehensible. Now, night before last at the Academy of Music, just after Signorina Sconcia had finished that exquisite melody, The Last Rose of Summer, one of these floral pile drivers came cleaving down through the atmosphere of applause, and if she hadn't deployed suddenly to the right, it would have driven her into the floor like a shingle nail. Of course, that bouquet was well meant, but how would you like to have been the target? A sincere compliment is always grateful to a lady, so long as you don't try to knock her down with it. Young Mother. And so you think a baby is a thing of beauty and a joy forever? Well, the idea is pleasing, but not original. Every cow thinks the same of its own calf. Perhaps the cow may not think it so elegantly, but still, she thinks it nevertheless. I honor the cow for it. We all honor this touching material instinct, wherever we find it, be it in the home of luxury or in the humble cowshed. But really, madam, when I come to examine the matter in all its bearings, I find that the correctness of your assertion does not manifest itself in all cases. A sore-faced baby with a neglected nose cannot be conscientiously regarded as a thing of beauty. And inasmuch as babyhood spans but 3 short years, no baby is competent to be a joy forever. It pains me thus to demolish 2/3 of your pretty sentiment in a single sentence. But the position I hold in this chair requires that I shall not permit you to deceive and mislead the public with your plausible figures of speech. I know a female baby, aged 18 months in this city, which cannot hold out as a joy 24 hours on a stretch, let alone forever. And it possesses some of the most remarkable eccentricities of character and appetite that have ever fallen under my notice. I will set down here a statement of this infant's operations, conceived, planned, and carried out by itself, and without suggestion or assistance from its mother or anyone else, during a single day. And what I shall say can be substantiated by the sworn testimony of witnesses. It commenced by eating 1 dozen large blue mass pills, box and all. Then it fell down a flight of stairs and arose with a bruised and purple knot on its forehead, after which it proceeded in quest of further refreshment and amusement. It found a glass trinket ornamented with brass work, smashed up and ate the glass, and then swallowed the brass. Then it drank about 20 drops of laudanum, and more than 12 tablespoonsful of strong spirits of camphor. The reason why it took no more landamin was because there was no more to take. After this, it laid down on its back, and shoved 5 or 6 inches of a silver-headed whalebone cane down its throat, got it fast there, and it was all its mother could do to pull the cane out again without pulling out some of the child with it. Then, being hungry for glass again, it broke up several wine glasses and fell to eating and swallowing the fragments, not minding a cut or two. Then it ate a quantity of butter, pepper, salt, and California matches, actually taking a spoonful of butter, a spoonful of salt, a spoonful of pepper, and 3 or 4 lucifer matches at each mouthful. I will remark here that this thing of beauty likes painted German lucifers and eats all she can get of them. But she infinitely prefers California matches, which I regard as a compliment to our home manufacturers of more than ordinary value, coming as it does from one who is too young to flatter. Then she washed her head with soap and water, and afterwards ate what soap was left and drank as much of the suds as she had room for, after which she sallied forth and took the cow familiarly by the tail and got kicked, heels over head. At odd times during the day, when this joy forever happened to have nothing particular on hand, she put in the time by climbing up on places and falling down off them, uniformly damaging herself in the operation. As young as she is, she speaks many words tolerably distinctly, and being plain-spoken in other respects, blunt and to the point, she opens conversations with all strangers, male or female, with the same formula. How do, Jim? Not being familiar with the ways of children, it is possible that I have been magnifying into matter of surprise things which may not strike anyone who is familiar with infancy as being at all astonishing. However, I cannot believe that such is the case, and so I repeat that my report of this baby's performances is strictly true. And if anyone doubts it, I can produce the child. I will further engage that she will devour anything that is given her, reserving to myself only the right to exclude anvils, and fall down from any place to which she may be elevated, merely stipulating that her preference for alighting on her head shall be respected, and therefore that elevation chosen shall be high enough to enable her to accomplish this to her satisfaction. But I find I have wandered from my subject, so without further argument, I will reiterate my conviction that not all babies are things of beauty and joys forever. Arithmeticus, Virginia, Nevada. I am an enthusiastic student of mathematics, and it is so vexatious to me to find my progress constantly impeded by these mysterious arithmetical technicalities. Now do tell me what the difference is between geometry and conchology. Here you come again with your diabolical arithmetical conundrums when I am suffering death with a cold in the head. If you could have seen the expression of ineffable scorn that darkened my countenance a moment ago and was instantly split from the center in every direction like a fractured looking glass by my last sneeze, you never would have written that disgraceful question. Conchology is a science which has nothing to do with mathematics. It relates only to shells. At the same time, however, a man who opens oysters for an hotel, or shells a fortified town, or sucks eggs, is not, strictly speaking, a conchologist. A fine stroke of sarcasm that, but it will be lost on such an intellectual clam as you. Now, Compare conchology and geometry together, and you will see what the difference is, and your question will be answered. But don't torture me with any more of your ghastly arithmetical horrors, for I do detest figures anyhow, until you know I am rid of my cold. I feel the bitterest animosity towards you at this moment. Bothering me in this way, when I could do nothing but sneeze and swear, and snort pocket handkerchiefs to atoms. If I had you in range of my nose now, I would blow your brains out. Socrates Murphy. You speak of having given offense to a gentleman at the opera by unconsciously humming an air which the tenor was singing at the time. Now, part of that is a deliberate falsehood. You are not doing it unconsciously. No man does such a mean, vulgar, egotistical thing as that unconsciously. You were doing it to show off. You wanted the people around you to know you had been to operas before and to think you were not such an ignorant, self-conceited, supercilious ass as you looked. I can tell you Arizona opera sharps any time. You prowl around beer cellars and listen to some howling dervish of a Dutchman exterminating an Italian air, and then you come into the academy and prop yourself up against the wall with the stuffy aspect and the imbecile leer of a clothing store dummy, and go to droning along about half an octave below the tenor, and disgusting everybody in your neighborhood with your beery strains. N.B. If this roughshod eloquence of mine touches you on a raw spot occasionally, recollect that I am talking for your good, Murphy, and that I am simplifying my language so as to bring it clearly within the margin of your comprehension. It might be gratifying to you to be addressed as if you were an Oxford graduate, but then you wouldn't understand it, you know. You have got another abominable habit, my sagebrush amateur. When one of those Italian footmen in British uniform comes in and sings, "O tol di roll, O signor ora, Luonga, Conga, Venezuela, whack fol di roll," which means, "O noble madam, here's one of them dukes from the palace out here, come to borrow a dollar and a half," you always stand with expanded eyes and mouth, and one pile driver uplifted, and your sprawling hands held apart in front of your face, like a couple of canvas-covered hams. And when he gets almost through, how you do uncork your pent-up enthusiasm and applaud with hoof and palm. You have it pretty much to yourself, and then you look sheepish when you find everybody staring at you. But how very idiotic you do look when something really fine is sung. You generally keep quiet then. Never mind, though, Murphy. Entire audiences do things at the opera that they have no business to do. For instance, they never let one of those $1,000 singers finish. They always break in with their ill-timed applause just as he or she, as the case may be, is preparing to throw all his or her concentrated sweetness into the final strain. And so, all that sweetness is lost. Write me again, Murphy. I shall always be happy to hear from you.